To many of us, the ocean may seem like a vast, mysterious place. But if you look closer, you'd find that the waters covering almost 3/4 of our planet hold a fascinating world, where rich communities of plants and animals live in a delicate balance. Every day, thousands of curious folks get to explore this world, not by putting on a wetsuit, but by visiting the nation's largest aquarium devoted to a single region, the Monterey Bay Aquarium, located on the coast of Central California. Here you'll find exhibits of Monterey Bay's diverse marine communities and discover thousands of colorful creatures from the bay, as well as more distant waters. You're about to go behind the scenes of this world-renowned aquarium, where you'll meet some of the staff members and volunteers who bring Monterey Bay within easy reach of everyone. Together, they make the aquarium a positive force in marine conservation. Our trip begins with the lush kelp forests of Monterey Bay, where aquarist Barbara Utter tends to these giant seaweeds found in the aquarium's kelp forest exhibit.
When you're diving, you just have this tremendous freedom. It's just like you're flying. You can cruise down into this canyon and say you're in the midwater and you're looking up at the surface and the sun is shining. There are all these rays coming down. There are fish above you and fish below you. It's just a whole different world. What we've tried to do at the Monterey Bay Aquarium is create the kelp forest for people that never dive and to bring the spectacular beauty of a kelp forest. We've brought kelp plants into the aquarium, and we've also brought a lot of the animals and plants that live in a kelp forest. I'm responsible for maintaining all the kelp and the algae in there, and so I'm sort of like an underwater gardener. I love getting out in the bay and collecting plants and animals and invertebrates. The greatest thing is to bring back a kelp plant and put it in. This is a giant kelp plant, and this is the holdfast, and this is what you would see when you're diving, and this is what attaches to the rock. We have a lot of maintenance to do in the kelp forest. We have to go out and get these adult plants, and the great thing about having the Monterey Bay right at your doorstep is that I have the pick of all the kelp plants in the bay, of course within reason. I want to get the most representative kelp plant out there with a nice flat holdfast like this, because you want the haptera, which are these little guys here, to grow and attach to our rocks in our kelp forest. We usually get a plant at about 20 to 30 feet because our kelp tank's 28 feet deep, and a lot of times I'll cut the holdfast a little bit so that it'll fit to the rock work. Then I'll take bungee cords out of my bag and I will attach them. It really is a spectacular exhibit. One of the things I love most is going to the kelp forest window and seeing people just looking at the kelp forest at awe. Just sort of the looks on their face are often enough to make me feel really good. And the great thing about it is it really rivals what's out there in terms of diversity. It's just spectacular.
From the aquarium's decks, you can often spot some of the bay's inhabitants, such as these California sea otters. Sea otters often forage for food close to the shore among kelp plants. A few sea otters raised by staff when they arrived as orphan pups call the aquarium home. Marcy Tarvit is one aquarist who cares for the residents of the sea otter exhibit.
Roscoe, get ready.
People usually think that otters are very cute and cuddly. They think that they're just these little animals or big animals that you can just pick up and hold on your lap. They're really not. They're wild otters. They're very capable of biting somebody if they were scared or forced to be cornered in a situation. And we treat them as such. Our otters are very curious. They like to try and explore their environment, their exhibit. Whenever we put anything new in the exhibit, whether it's a toy or even a new plant that we plant, they're often on it right away. And if you think about that, similar to what an otter out in the wild would do, they often try and find things to eat, so they have to work really hard at something. They're very diligent. Okay. The otters know their name, so when we call their name, they look to us for attention.
Good.
We do use positive reinforcement, we use operant conditioning, and we try and make it a very positive session. So whenever we ask them to do something, if it's close to what we're asking, we reinforce them. She's actually just gonna go pick the target up, the float at the very end, and she's gonna focus her attention by just holding it. And she's gonna remain calm. And as she remains calm, we reinforce her for that. So we say, Goldie, good. And then give her a piece of food. The word good tells her that what she did is the right thing. Would you like to join us?
Haley.
Otters have good days and bad days, just like trainers. Sometimes they'll be ready to listen and be really active and attentive, and other times they'd rather just sleep on the overflow or maybe take a few pieces of food and then go their merry way. And when that happens, that's fine with us. They have very different personalities. They're very much individuals. Goldie's a very active otter. She likes to get into anything that she can. She'll be the first one to go over by a new item that we put on the deck, maybe a new toy, and investigate it, pull it into the water, and then it's hers. And Haley's more laid back. She waits till Goldie does a lot of the work, gets the object off the deck, and then tries to go steal it from her. And Roscoe is he likes to associate with people. He's more interested in people at times than with his own tank mates. Otters are really wild animals, and they wouldn't normally just let us pet them or walk up to them and hold their flipper. So it's taken us a while for them to get used to us slowly touching them and make sure that their hind flippers look normal, that they don't have any nicks or scratches on them, and they're allowing us to do that.
Roscoe, right on?
They're very intelligent. They're constantly trying to think of what they can do with the next step, and many times they improvise on behaviors.
Good.
They're very creative.
Keeping the aquarium's creatures healthy is a task that requires both care and compassion. Veterinarian Tom Williams, here in the Sea Otter Nursery, has been working with sea otters since 1971, helping to ensure their survival.
The otter pup is very fragile. It's just like a newborn human infant, and a lot of times it's almost like a preemie.
Can I check you out? How's those eyes? They're nice and bright.
I usually, especially the first week or two, will listen to their chest, make sure that they don't have pneumonia, because as a baby, they get susceptible to pneumonia.
The right side is really good, and the left side is good. Okay, it's nice and clear. That's fine.
The sea otter does not have subcutaneous fat, so the only insulation they have is their pelage, which is about 3/4 of an inch thick. If they lose the pelage, if it gets wet or whatever, then the animal is in trouble. In feeling the pelage, it has a good elasticity to it, so I know that this pup is really well hydrated. And I usually feel the flippers to make sure that they're not too warm or too cold. It gives me an idea of the temperature.
You're just fine from nose to toes.
I think that the aquarium has done a lot towards conservation of an individual species. We have taken a pup that 20 years ago would normally die. We have studied all the veterinary and husbandry parameters of that animal so we could then apply that to not only each individual animal, but to the population as a whole.
In the aquarium's aviary, you can see a variety of shorebirds strutting along the sandy beaches and paddling in muddy marshes. The exhibit resembles a slice of Elkhorn Slough, a wetland sanctuary near the aquarium. Veterinarian Mike Murray cares for the birds and the other animals here.
The primary job here for the aviary is actually to provide the visitor to the aquarium the opportunity to get very, very close to animals that they could not approach within several dozen yards in the wild. You actually can get so close that you can appreciate how the feathers lie down, how the tip of these long-billed beaks tends to flex as they forage for food. The majority of the birds that we acquire here for the collection are actually rehabilitation birds, those that have been injured through some accident, either with humans or with nature. We then rehabilitate the bird to the point that it is suitable for the collection, ensuring that it actually will fit into the group, not causing too much bird-to-bird aggression or interaction. Baby birds are of particular concern for us because the requirements of the rapid growth of the infant bird are very, very demanding. We don't know what the nutritional requirements for individual growing birds are, so we have to watch very, very carefully. One of the interesting things we found in working with these birds in captivity is that there's not a lot of information on their medical and biological care. And we've found that as we've worked with these birds over the years, that we've been able to share it with our colleagues in the veterinary medical field to aid not only birds in other zoological parks and aquariums, but more importantly, with how we manage these wild populations as they migrate through North America.
In the diverse habitats of Monterey Bay, you'll find an amazing variety of creatures, including at least 33 different species of sharks. The aquarium's unique Monterey Bay Habitats exhibit showcases a variety of these sharks as well as other local residents in a setting that combines four distinct bay environments: the deep reefs, the sandy seafloor, the shale reefs, and the wharf. Aquarist Manny Escura is one of several staff members who tends the exhibit on a regular basis.
The nice thing about this is that we don't have the sharks in a separate exhibit. We have them in as part of the community tank because they are part of the community you find in Monterey Bay. The leopard sharks, they're real common animals in estuaries. They'll come in with the tides, they'll feed on stuff there like crabs and innkeeper worms, bite off some clam siphons, and then they'll boogie out. Some of the dogfish that we have in this tank, they're called spiny dogfish, and you'll learn that the hard way if you go try to grab them. They've got two spines right in front of the dorsal fins, and they're toxic, so that will hurt. These seven gills live in shallow waters. You'll find them in estuaries. They also seem to be more primitive than some of the more advanced sharks. And for the seven gills, we've got some nice salmon fillets. What I'd just like to do is try to keep track of how much I'm going to feed out, so I'm weighing out what we're going to feed to them. Instead of just throwing it in, we've been using poles. They're a little bit finicky, so you want to make sure you get the food right in front of them. The amount that they're feeding, you know, it's probably not as much as people would think. If anything, they don't feed that much. They kind of feed in cycles, mainly just because their metabolism is a lot lower than something like a pelagic fish, like a tuna. Those guys really are ravenous feeders. Here comes our big girl. There we go. When we're diving in the exhibit, the sharks know we're there for sure. Most people have the stereotypical image that these sharks would be on us and it's a really dangerous thing, and that's not really true. We do like to leave the animals room so we don't crowd them, but mostly so they don't turn away from us and hit a rock or the window. The hourglass shape of the tank, what that was designed to do is give the sharks in general a long glide path and then plenty of room to make a nice curve. And that way they're using the muscles on either side of their bodies. What we're trying to do is educate the public about the role of these animals, because predators are important to communities. They really have an effect on the shaping of the communities. That's why we want to see that they're protected. They are a really crucial and beautiful part of the marine ecosystems.
Sometimes you have to look hard to find the creatures in the aquarium. Many animals find unique hiding places, and some blend right into their environments. The giant Pacific octopus is a master of disguise and can change color, shape, and texture instantly. For senior aquarist John Hoche, feeding this eight-armed creature is quite a challenge.
She's just a gorgeous animal. One of the reasons I really love working with these octopuses is the fact that they are so, as invertebrates go, very intelligent, very personable animals, as you can see here. Not at all like the animal you hear about, capable of taking down ships and eating people. They're actually can be quite friendly. As you can well imagine, with these eight arms that she has, their tactile sense is very acute. And she's actually, as she's touching me and the food with those arms, she's not only feeling me, but also she's able to actually smell by using those suction cups and placing them on objects. You can see her eyes, one on each side of her head, here and here, and they're very well adapted to seeing in low light conditions, both underwater and out of water, so they have a very keen sense of sight. And I'm just feeding her some real good high quality shrimp here. Octopus eat a number of things in the wild, one of which is crustaceans. They love to feed on crabs and lobsters and shrimp, and we try to feed them things that are very similar to, if not identical, to what they're getting in the wild. And what she's actually doing here is she grabs the shrimp from me using those suction cups, and then using the arm, she's actually drawing the food into a central mouth. You might be able to see the central area here where all the arms join, and right in this area here. And she actually has a large beak, very much like a parrot beak, and she's actually using that beak to crunch this food up and ultimately swallow and digest. Her color changes dramatically as her mood changes and as she's getting food or changing her position relative to the various different lights. You can see she's gone from a real dark red to almost a pale white here. So she's constantly running oxygen-rich water over her gills and also eliminating waste that way. Whoa, Nellie! Look at her go. They are also prey items. Large fish with very large mouths, like sharks and large groupers and things like that, will also prey on octopus. And so they have to concern themselves with the fence. And the fact that they can swim so quickly by using their siphon to jet out, and also by spewing out a jet of black ink, helps confuse the potential predator, and so they have a good defense as well. Octopus in general are just amazing escape artists. The only hard part of their body, their anatomy, is that hard chitinous beak that they use to feed. And on a large Pacific giant octopus like this 25, 30 pounder here, the beak is only a few inches in diameter. And that's really all that restricts them to getting through small openings. So theoretically, this animal could easily squeeze through a few inch diameter hole. So it's pretty amazing.
Offering the public a complete view of Monterey Bay has been a long-term goal of the aquarium. In 1996, 12 years after it opened, the aquarium introduced its visitors to the open ocean through a series of thrilling displays in its outer bay wing. The centerpiece of the wing is a million-gallon exhibit where a variety of open ocean species swim in an expansive environment. Visitors get to view these residents through the world's largest single-paned window, weighing 78,000 pounds.
We wanted to give visitors a sense of being immersed in the open ocean. So we try to provide them with suggestions. Suggestions about dark space, about blue space. We put them into this really different space, and then we depend on their imaginations to carry them 60 miles offshore. Visitors can see and learn about animals that they can't see like this anywhere else in the world. It's a little like being on one of those nature television specials,
except they're right here and they're standing in the middle of it.
With more water than all of the aquarium's other exhibits combined, the Outer Bay exhibit is home to the ocean sunfish, large green sea turtles, schools of tuna, and other species of fish. Chuck Farwell, curator of pelagic fishes, describes some of the fastest inhabitants of the exhibit, the tuna.
The tuna as a group are quite remarkable, and if you look at their body shape, they're very streamlined. It allows them to travel through the water without wasting a lot of energy through frictional loss. The eyes have a membrane that grows over them, so there is no protuberance of an eye into the water. The tail fin has a lunate shape, which is very efficient at high speeds. When the tuna want to travel very quickly, you can only barely perceive the beat of the tail because it is so rapid. We have a community of different species of fish all living together in close proximity. The challenge to our aquarium staff is to be able to give an adequate diet to all of the fish without overfeeding one group of fish at the cost of one of the other groups. One of the things that we found out early on is that the yellowfin tuna are extremely aggressive feeders. They're very fast, very agile in the water, and they can outcompete most of the other fish for food. So what we try to do is feed the smaller fish first by having a lot of food cut up into small pieces and let the smaller fish get their fill, and then we come in and start feeding the larger fish larger pieces of food such as whole squid or whole fish. Tunas have a very high metabolic rate, which means that they consume large amounts of oxygen, and the life support system that we built for this exhibit was built to accommodate a large collection of tunas. We hope to become more effectively evolved in the conservation of tunas, so we're very concerned that these fish be regulated or monitored in a way that they can be preserved for posterity.
The uniquely shaped ocean sunfish, also known as Mola Mola, or Mola for short, is named for its habit of basking in the sun at the surface of the water. Aquarist Tim Cook cares for these friendly creatures.
Molas are quite different than other fish due to their shape and their physical makeup. I don't know of many other fish that are shaped like that. They actually use for locomotion their dorsal and anal fin, and their actual tail, which is called the clavis, is just used as a rudder. They stabilize themselves also by using their pectoral fins. When we first collected them, we knew it was going to be a big challenge in the large tank with other species of fish. Tuna are very aggressive fish, and they don't stop at anything to eat. And if we just threw the food in for the molas would not really have an opportunity to find that food and consume it. So with the development in our team to devise a way to feed the molas, we've come up with a target, a lot like marine mammals get. And the target is a yellow color because there isn't anything else in the tank that resembles that color or that shape.
Mola have a beak that they use to bite things off or possibly crush them. Their beak is very sharp when they're real tiny. But as they get bigger, it turns more into a hard bone. And they have teeth that look like cat claws in their throat, which they use to shred their food. Their growth is incredibly fast. We've recorded in a month the smaller ones doubling in weight from 10 pounds to 20 pounds. I don't know of many other fish that have great personalities like they do. They are pretty special.
The Outer Bay exhibit includes two green sea turtles. Green sea turtles live in the tropics, but sometimes follow warm currents north to the Outer Bay. Senior aquarist Steve Brorson tells about the first turtle to live in the exhibit, a former resident of the Aquarium for Wildlife Conservation in New York.
When we first got our green sea turtle, we were concerned with how the other fish would react to his presence. The molas in particular are shy and temperamental animals, and we were worried that they might go off their food or have some other negative type behavior as a result of his introduction, but that wasn't a problem at all. We think that perhaps the Mola Molas think that the green sea turtle is just another Mola Mola on its side. Our green sea turtle has adapted quite well in our exhibit. In fact, he joins in the tuna when they're being fed. The green sea turtle has a large, round, smooth carapace, also known as its shell, two large flippers that he uses for locomotion, two rear flippers that he uses pretty much as rudders. While a male has a larger, longer tail, the male and the female reach approximately the same maximum size. He's 35 to 40 years old, about 230 pounds, and he's about 3 feet long. And green sea turtles have been reported to exceed 600 pounds in weight. The green sea turtle has a large beak, which is serrated, which it can use for tearing food apart. Although it does have a large beak, it's the most gentle of the sea turtles, and it's the least likely to bite or snap. Our green sea turtle is special because he's fed from the surface, and although he's an herbivore, in captivity he's adapted to an omnivore diet. He's fed lettuce or kale first, and as a reward he gets his squid and his whitebait smelt. That's his favorite food. He's well adjusted now and he seems to be quite happy.
Visitors entering the Outer Bay Wing are greeted by a 15,000-gallon roundabout exhibit where more than 3,000 silvery anchovies glitter overhead.
You know, one of the questions we get a lot about this exhibit is, why are the anchovies swimming all in one direction? Every time you come by here, they're swimming the same way. And the answer, as far as I can tell, is they're just swimming with the current. They're just taking the direction that uses the least amount of energy. These anchovies are actually very lucky animals because they were getting ready to be sold as bait. We went down and bought live anchovies, moved them in our transport tank up here, and moved them into the display.
In order to clean the acrylic windows in our aquariums, we use special pads that are very non-abrasive. Acrylic is very, very clear, but fragile plastic. It can be scratched very easily. So we use these non-abrasive pads, and the aquarist rule is to go from top to bottom, side to side, slowly moving the pad across the acrylic.
We feed these fish about 10 pounds of krill a day. Krill is a plankton, and they filter it out of the water by opening their jaws. They go through a lot of food because these fish use up a lot of energy. They're constantly swimming.
We know the anchovies are full by basically watching their behavior. We can calculate the average body weight of the anchovies, and then knowing that they will eat a certain percentage of their body weight every day, know we're close. We do supplement it with vitamin C and flake food, but the bulk is this 10 pounds of krill daily.
One of the things that we found is to be very critical with this exhibit is with this quantity of fish that need high amounts of oxygen because they live out in the open sea where there is high levels of oxygen, we're not able to maintain that oxygen level without supplementing it with liquid oxygen. So we're pumping it into the exhibit. You can't tell it's going in, but the fish can, and we're keeping them healthy and happy with artificial supply of oxygen.
The Outer Bay Wing includes a drifter's gallery, which features the largest permanent collection of jellies in the United States.
I've found that there's an incredible diversity of jellies. I had no idea that there were so many different types, sizes, and varieties that are found just here in Monterey Bay. You know, it's incredible. We get them from a couple of sources. Some of them we collect from the wild out in Monterey Bay, and others we actually grow here at the aquarium. There's several challenges in collecting the jellies. One is that they're not always out there. So we can spend days, weeks, or even months without seeing the particular jelly that we're after. And then collecting them, we have to be very careful because they are so delicate. So that when we do collect them, we can't lift them out with nets like you might a fish. We actually scoop them up usually with plastic bags. It's very important for us to raise the jellies here at the aquarium because we can't always rely on getting them out in the bay. We start off with what are known as polyps. They're like anemones and they're attached to the sides of dishes. Periodically, they'll release tiny jellies that are known as ephyra. And we'll collect those little jellies and usually start them off with newly hatched brine shrimp. And from there, we'll grow them up and put them in progressively larger tanks until they're ready for display once they reach the proper size. The tanks we use are a special design. They're known as chrysals. There's a circular current that moves the jellies around in a pattern that keeps them up off the bottom and away from the sides of the tank. And that way, we prevent injury to their very delicate bodies. I think most people think jellies are deadly creatures, that if there's a jelly out in the water, it's going to come after you and try to get you and sting you to death. In truth, most jellies are harmless to people, very delicate creatures that are up to 95% or more water. They don't have any kind of a brain And despite all this, they've been around for over 500 million years and actually play a crucial role in marine ecosystems. They can consume a significant amount of zooplankton biomass that's out in any marine ecosystem. And we're hoping to make people realize that they're actually some of the most beautiful and interesting creatures in the sea.
Several types of food are used to feed the drifters. The first and smallest of these is algae, which begins the food chain as a primary source of nutrients. Aquarist Sydney Snyder helps to cultivate food for the jellies.
The second type of food that we use in the Drifter's Gallery is a small, little animal type of plankton called a rotifer. These animals we actually use to feed some of the more juvenile forms of our jellyfish. We use the algae that you saw a little bit earlier to feed the rotifers. So a bigger guy eats a smaller guy. You can't tell what the actual animal looks like without looking at them under a microscope. But the jellies know exactly what they are and find them as food. One of our most important sources of food for our jellies starts out in this form, which are brine shrimp eggs. Once these are hydrated in water, they actually hatch out as baby brine shrimp, which are called nauplii. What I'm actually doing here is draining our two-day-old brine shrimp nauplii, little crustaceans, into a net where we collect them and concentrate them. After a period of 24 hours, they're fed a very rich, fatty food that makes them very good food in turn, which we use to feed larger forms of the jellies.
Each aquarium exhibit holds a unique marine community. Bringing life to every exhibit is a gentle art that takes expert care, a talent honed by senior collector John O'Sullivan during his many years with the aquarium.
All the aquarists that work in the aquarium are basically either marine biologists or have an ecology or biology background. We're all very sensitive to the needs of the animals, and we take that into account whenever collecting them. All the aquarists that work in their galleries are basically collectors for that gallery. We rotate the aquarists through their various galleries on a yearly basis. That gives them a good broad knowledge of all the exhibits at the aquarium. The one fallback is that each aquarist, as they go into a new exhibit, is going through a learning curve. So it's everyone's responsibility to work with each other through the exhibits as the collections come in, go through quarantine if it's needed, and onto exhibit.
I actually got one of those snub-nosed poachers that I haven't seen in a long time.
Because of the seasonality of animals, we only can rely on getting some things at certain sizes at certain times of year. There's also seasonality of animals that move into the warmer or colder waters that we have to rely on to be able to collect them at those times.
You dragging up any giant skate egg cases?
We get them, I'll see them.
We rely on commercial fishermen up and down the state of California to help us with collections of various species. And as they work the bottoms for fish for the market and restaurants, they're able to collect things for us that we need. For us, some of the most difficult animals to collect are the ones that drift in the open waters, because there's very little data that says, okay, this is when you should go out and get it. So we just have to go out on the water and just keep looking, sometimes day after day, until we just find the white water mass that has these animals incorporated in it, and then get them when we can. It's important when you develop a display with animals in it that you have them throughout the year. That's where we come into trying to be able to raise or culture animals, and that becomes very important with certain types of jellies. Not only because we can have them year-round, but we might also be able to have the size that we need. Many times we will not collect if the conditions or the means haven't been developed yet. Even though it might take us years of R&D to be able to develop the means for putting certain animals on exhibit, the goals and the satisfaction of what we can create after that happens is, I believe, very beneficial to the aquarium and to the public in the learning of the conservation of the world's oceans.
To keep all of the animals, invertebrates, and hundreds of species of fish healthy, John DiGirolamo, a food specialist, prepares their meals.
We're going to start off by making some krill shakes. Krill is a shrimp-like plankton. These compose a major part of our diet, just as they are in the raw. But we also take them and we blend them up. We take a little bit here. pop that on the scale. We'll get ourselves 2.5 pounds of this fresh krill. Fresh frozen krill, I should say. It is frozen at sea. To top that off, we'll grab some of our clams here. And the clams we put in about 1.5 pounds. Try to make this right consistency so that it comes out of the bottles, the squirt bottles we have here. And being not too thick and not too thin, we want to make sure it's the right consistency. And there we go, there's about 4 pounds there. About 1/2 pound of flake food over the top. We'll take that stuff right out. Beautiful fresh flake food. Now to top this stuff off, what we want to do is add some of our special vitamins. We have a concoction here of zoo vitamins, which we add by the tablespoon. Add a little amount in that. And our amino acid complex to make sure our animals grow at the optimal growth rates. And there we go. We're gonna top this off. Our food room is equipped almost like none other. We have fresh running seawater lines, and we can use this to rinse our fish off, or in this case, to create our krill shakes. We top that puppy right off. And there we go. The essence of krill shake. The krill shakes are eaten by the invertebrate animals we have here. All the animals that are invertebrates will filter feed this material here, which is very, very rich in nutrients. It's otter time. We're gonna start off with a little bit of rock cod. What we're doing with a lot of the food here is we're utilizing the food as a reinforcement, a positive reinforcement for the animals. So instead of giving a big piece of snapper, we're giving smaller pieces, and we're actually chopping it a little bit smaller. Yeah, that's close enough. Give them a little treat, you know? There we go. Let's add it in here. Our next menu item is the clams, the surf clams here. The actual clams themselves come with the adductor muscles and the funnel and the actual foot itself. The sea otters eat the foot. We sort through a few of these here. We'll be all set. Cut these right in half. We bisect them right down the middle. And that gives our animals what they want. Shrimp is one of the most stable items that we have here for the otter program. What's different about our preparation is that we peel all the shrimp. The otters, being as dexterous as they are, they will actually take the shrimp and peel it themselves, leaving the casings, which is definitely not something you want the visitors to see on the bottom of the tank. So what we do is we peel for them, and we go ahead and peel close to about 5 pounds of shrimp a day for these animals. Next item we're going to do, we're going to put some Monterey Bay calamari in here, and we try to put a lot of squid into all of our diets. It's a real good source of protein and real good source of nutrients. The quality of our food that we have in here exceeds human-grade consumption. The actual food itself is of quality, much, much better than what you find almost in any store itself. We shop for the best quality we can find. And additionally, we actually bring in a lot of this product frozen. We know that they're frozen right at the point of origin. They're frozen right at the boat. There are no parasites, so there's no contaminations. It is the freshest and the best that we can possibly find. It is the best quality seafood money can buy. The otters themselves eat approximately 6 pounds per feeding, and they eat 4 times a day. The amount of food that they eat ranges about $10,000 per animal, and we don't skimp at all on the quality. We buy just the very best for our otters.
In addition to its staff, the aquarium runs on the energy and commitment of hundreds of volunteers who reach thousands of curious visitors every day.
The young lady said, "How is it you're not afraid of your fingers?"
I get the same sort of satisfaction that a teacher would get, that of imparting knowledge and seeing the glint of recognition in the people's faces.
I love it. I've been here since 1984, and it's always different, and it's always exciting, and it's an ongoing learning process. I certainly learn a lot about people, and it's just a fabulous education.
Slimy. One of the major focuses of the aquarium is education. The job of guides in our aquarium is to help people enjoy their experience here, not only children, but for adults as well.
Yeah, that's an abalone, and she's attached to a rock. Monterey Bay Aquarium has a sister institution known as MABARI, the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute. Exploring the ocean's depths and interpreting its mysteries is the primary role of MABARI, which uses state-of-the-art technology to study the deep, alien-like world of Monterey Canyon, covering hundreds of square miles at depths greater than 10,000 feet. Using its uniquely designed remotely operated vehicles, carrying video cameras and special collecting equipment, MABARI scientists and engineers study many aspects of the canyon, including the deep sea creatures who live in a habitat of perpetual night. Through video technology, images of Monterey Canyon are transmitted live through a microwave link to the aquarium, where visitors can watch what MABARI researchers are exploring. In the near future, MABARI and the aquarium will work together to introduce visitors to the deep sea of Monterey Canyon, both in an effort to educate and to inspire public commitment to the world's oceans.
One of the primary misconceptions was, what's down there? It's a deep, dark environment with probably not a lot of food. What can even survive down there? And what I've learned from the opposite is that there's a tremendous diversity of animals in terms of their color, shape, sizes, and lifestyles. One of the really unique things about the deep sea is that there are different environments. And one of the really interesting ones are the canyon wall environments. And there's just an incredible diversity of animals. For example, these sea fans or gorgonians, some of them reach heights of 4 feet and maybe hundreds of years old. Most people probably don't even think these look much like animals, yet they are. They're like huge sieves on the wall, which filter out all kinds of food particles that are swept by via some of the currents. Another group of animals that is really exciting are the sponges. These kind of pointy sponge right here, I call the stegosaur sponge. And they're unique in that they grow very slow and they get very large. In some cases, there's a whole community of animals that use the sponge as a refuge. Other animals that we see in the canyon wall environment are the soft corals. We call them toadstools from Mars. And these red organisms here actually have a stalk and then what looks like kind of a mushroom head and then polyps which extend out from that mushroom head. And they have finely branched tentacles which they use to trap food items as they're swept by through the currents. One of the most bizarre animals that we've come across here in the Monterey Canyon lives at about 1,200 feet. We call it a carnivorous or a predatory tunicate. We feed the animals here in the deep sea lab two or three times a week. The predatory tunicates, we feed them enriched brine shrimp and basically use a turkey baster to inject the brine shrimp into the oral hood, and then the animal typically will close down and ingest it whole. And you can actually follow the food through the digestive tract in the next several days. They're permanently attached to a rock so they can't move around. One of the unique things about this animal we found was that it requires low oxygen in order to have long-term survivorship. One of the most unique animals that lives in the midwater zone are some of the crustaceans. For example, this deep sea lobster larvae here. These are animals that never encounter any wall or hard spaces. And so we have to come up with tank designs to keep these animals suspended in the midwater zone, so to speak, in order to maintain them. They're also some of the most delicate animals, many of them gelatinous, very little skeletal mass to them, but indeed are some of the most bizarre creatures people will ever see in that type of environment.
Beyond fostering knowledge of the bay through its exhibits and leading-edge technologies, the aquarium is also dedicated to protecting marine communities, a long-standing commitment of the aquarium's executive director, Julie Packard.
Visitors to the aquarium may think that all of our efforts focus on our exhibits, but in fact our conservation programs go far beyond what you just see here at the aquarium. For example, our sea otter research and conservation program is helping us build the knowledge we'll need to manage this threatened population for future generations. Another program that we have here at the aquarium is our tuna research and conservation program. We're very concerned about the future of tunas and pelagic fishes across the Pacific and in fact the world's oceans. And we have a very exciting initiative underway with Stanford University to study tunas and learn as much as we can about them in order to best manage them in the wild. Some of the collaborative projects we're working on involve better ways to tag these fish and actually track their movements throughout the world's oceans. With this kind of information, we'll be able to do a much better job at understanding why some of these populations are in decline and what we can best do about it.
In 1996, the Monterey Bay Aquarium turned 12 years old. Since opening, nearly 21 million visitors from throughout the world have come to discover the magic of Monterey Bay. As public awareness about the bay and the world's oceans has grown, so has the commitment to protect them.
We're finding people want to join conservation groups. They want to know how to get in touch with their politicians to express their views, and we're really pleased to see the general public awareness of ocean conservation really improving over the past decade. For example, due in large part to the public awareness generated here at the aquarium, Monterey Bay is now the nation's largest national marine sanctuary. The sanctuary ensures that harmful activities like oil drilling are prevented, but allows ongoing use by the public, hopefully in a way that will keep the bay healthy for future generations.
If you'd like to find out more about marine conservation, or learn about the aquarium's special programs and activities, you can write to the Monterey Bay Aquarium Foundation, 886 Cannery Row, Monterey, California, 93940-1085. You can also log on to the aquarium's website, www.mbayaq.org. The Monterey Bay Aquarium is a non-profit public institution. One goal lies behind all it does: to help protect the world's oceans.